I'm Brittany Krawczyk. I live in Saskatoon, Saskatchewan. I am unemployed due to my illness.
My name is Emma. I'm a 19-year-old university student. In 2022, I had my first diagnosis of a spinal CSF leak. And since, I've been trying to manage everything that comes with that.
Hi, my name's Ingrid, and I'm an elementary school teacher in Ontario, Canada. And I suffered from a CSF leak in March of 2016.
Hi, my name is Jolene Hanrahan, and for 4.5 years, I suffered with a spinal CSF leak.
I am Paul. I live in Calgary, Alberta. In June 2015, I fell and hit my head, and that was pretty much that. My life changed in an instant.
My name is Pierre Bergeron. I have been sick from the CSF leak problem since October 2017.
Before my CSF leak, I was very active in playing competitive soccer. When I was 6 weeks old, I was diagnosed with obstructive hydrocephalus due to a tectal glioma and had my first VP shunt at 7 weeks old. I had no medical issues growing up and was never a headachey person overall.
Before I got sick, I was happy and healthy. I was active. I loved to run. Our kids were super busy, so we were constantly bringing them to and from their various extracurricular activities. I worked full-time with the federal government as an IT specialist. From a medical standpoint, I mean, I was healthy. I had been diagnosed with type 2 diabetes, but it was well managed. From a headache perspective, I mean, I knew what it felt like to have headaches, but they were just normal, and I could take an Advil and get relief from them. I honestly had no idea what I was in store for.
I did lots of canoeing and swimming at our cottage. We built all kinds of things at the cottage to improve it. My husband and I had traveled all over the world. We were avid scuba divers. I practiced yoga for 15 years before becoming incapacitated from my leak. And we were extremely outdoorsy, kind of active people, and had a great life.
Prior to this CSF leak problem, I never had any type of health problem. I was a sportsman and doing all activities in a very enjoyable life. Nor I had any type of headaches before. Migraines or headaches were, I was headache free.
Before I fell, I was a very healthy individual. I had no headache issues at all. I was very fit. I worked out. I ran Spartan races, which are 5K obstacle course races, which I can tell you are not targeted at people over 50 like me. I hiked, I played golf, I rode a bike. I was very active. I was newly married. Life was good.
My symptoms have almost been consistent since July of 2022, and it started off by getting positional headaches that would start later in the day. And then I'd get really intense headaches at night with spinal pain as well. And with that, I would try to take Tylenol and Advil, and nothing ever touched the pain. And then it progressed to the where I am now, where I could only be upright for a certain amount of time, and that amount of time has decreased over time. And ultimately, sleep was the only relief I would get.
Brittany's symptoms started as early as the age of 3, and by the time she was 10, she was very much debilitated. I struggle with very debilitating headaches, if you can call them headaches even. I can't, lights, sounds really get to me. I live in a blacked out basement, pretty much bedridden at this point, and have been for years. I'm always nauseous. Really, I don't live. I just try to survive with all my symptoms and the pain.
I know I'll never forget the day that my symptoms started. I woke with an excruciating headache. I tried some over-the-counter medications and nothing brought any relief. On day three, I started to experience some new symptoms. It was a sharp, pulsing, shooting pain that would start at the base of my head and almost arc up over into my eye, my right eye. The pain was just excruciating. It felt like I had an intense burning pain in my head.
The onset of my symptoms came sort of in the middle of the night. So my husband and I moved a huge armoire down some stairs. When we got to the bottom of the stairs, I had a very strange feeling that sort of overcame me from the top of my head to the tip of my toes. And that night when I went to bed, I was fine. At 3 o'clock in the morning, I woke up and I had an excruciating headache. I was covered in sweat from head to toe. And that sort of is where the nightmare began.
I went golfing. Unfortunately, I did not exercise enough before going golfing. So at the exact same spot, hole number two, I remember well. I hit it enormous drives, 300 yards drives. And by hitting this so hard, I felt electric shock all on my spine, from top to bottom. And it happens that it created two CSF venous fistula. So in the next days, it was a nightmare because my headaches were so terrible. So I went to the emergency 4 times in a period of 1 week.
I'd say symptom onset was about 3 to 4 months after my concussion should have resolved. The pain in my head was really bad at this point. It was at the top of my head. It felt like the top of my head wanted to explode but couldn't. I was also having great difficulty with physical or mental exertion, as both of these things made my head pain worse. The only relief I could get from my head pain was to lie down. It was even difficult to have a simple conversation with someone. And essentially at this point, I was forced into early retirement. Then in 2019, things got really bad. My eye muscles, I couldn't move them and were very painful. My eyes became extremely sensitive to light. It was so bad that my wife had to cover up the windows in the house so I could come out of the bedroom. My ears became hugely sensitive to sound. But worst of all was my facial pain. My facial pain was it felt like I had been dragged across a gravel road. It was so bad. At this point, I couldn't do anything. And at this point, I'm at an emotional low. Maybe my emotional pain was worse than my physical pain. I had lost my independence. I was isolated. And I had lost any sense of myself. My identity.
Brittany has had numerous CSF leak diagnoses over the course of the 20 years, so it's hard for me to say, you know, time frame for each one of them, but on average, months to a year before a diagnosis. It depends on which time we're talking about. The last one that she had was a significant dural tear, which was surgically corrected. And then there was a pinhole puncture that took well over a year to deal with. That's her last leak. And that one we did have to travel for, and she did have a DSM, which actually showed no leak at the time.
It took 4 years to finally get a diagnosis of SIH. And that's with living in the same city as a neurologist that has an expertise in SIH. Early on, I saw a doctor who said I had post-concussion syndrome and that would be the new normal for me. My wife and I couldn't accept that diagnosis. And I spent the first 4 years trying to find a cure for post-concussion syndrome. In that time, I saw well over a dozen doctors. And towards the end there, a doctor suggested I check out the Calgary Headache Assessment and Management Program. And that's where I finally got my diagnosis for SIH. My MRI was negative. I had a CT myelogram done, and it showed several suspicious sites. So that plus my clinical presentation was enough to keep moving forward.
For my first leak diagnosis, I had a team of three pediatric neurosurgeons, and I had an MRI. However, the leak was found through a cisternogram. I had the leak surgically repaired. However, my symptoms returned shortly afterwards. In trying to find this leak, I had another cisternogram, and then I also saw a neuroradiologist for a CT myelogram. I then saw an adult neurosurgeon as I graduated into adult care and had further CT scans and MRIs, and nothing ever really, none of the imaging was able to detect the leak. My MRIs have shown that I have small ventricles, and my recent MRI has shown some brain seg. Nearly a year and a half later, I was able to go to the Mayo Clinic for the photon counting CT myelogram, and that was able to detect two leaks, and I further had an embolization.
Honestly, I never really did. I've never had those words spoken to me, "You have a spinal CSF leak." If anything, it was the opposite. All of my imaging and tests came back normal. Right from that first brain MRI to spinal MRIs that I had done, I had a CT myelogram done locally, and that came back normal. Had a lumbar puncture that had an opening pressure of 12 and was told that that was low normal. So that was enough to get me a blood patch that I had done locally here, but I had no relief from that. I had reached out to Duke University. It wasn't until Duke treated me, they ended up doing four multi-level blood patches and used fibrin glue. I walked away unsure if it was going to work, and I'm just so happy to be here today, 2 years and 2 months later, to say that it did.
My road to being diagnosed was extremely long and very difficult. My symptoms were all the hallmarks of a CSF leak, although most of the people that I ran into did not believe me when I told them that I thought I had this. In the beginning, I had no idea what it was. I just kept going with the same symptoms to the ER, and they kept telling me they didn't know what to do with me. And then, of course, because I had just turned 50, that it had to be a hormonal imbalance. As it turned out, after months and months of digging and finding different information for myself, I just kept knocking on neurology doors and seeing what would happen. I finally found, through the help of my GP, a neurologist, and this neurologist thought that things seemed a little bit fishy and thought perhaps we were correct, that I did possibly have a CSF leak. Even with his idea that it was going to be a positive diagnosis, it still took us almost 12 months to get a diagnosis or to get anything that resembled a diagnosis. I had my first blood patch a year after I started leaking, and I had immediate relief within 10 minutes. Unfortunately, I was leaking again within about 6 weeks, and it took me another 9 months or so before I was able to be treated with a multi-level blood patch at Duke University.
In my case, it was very fast. I've had the formal written diagnostic within 2 weeks, which is a miracle. I think so. The location of my CSF leaks was a nightmare. It took almost 5 years to get the exact location of my two small CSF venous fistula.
I've been fortunate to have such an incredible neurosurgeon and neurosurgery team who has always listened to me, reassures me, and has always told me that they'll never give up in fixing me.
And I had help from the Spinal CSF Leak Canada organization. They were just beautiful souls who tried to help me.
We have had a wonderful neurologist here in Canada who has really believed in Brittany throughout these last 20 years and through all of our stuff. She's supported us very well and actually sent us down to the States in 2020. And currently looking at another referral out of country at this time.
Well, my two local doctors, one neurologist, one interventional neuroradiologist, have helped me a lot. And also a few doctors from outside, from Calgary and also Minnesota. I will be forever thankful to them and their staff for everything they've done with me.
Honestly, say this is the most devastating thing that I've ever gone through. I wish doctors understood the severity of the pain and just how completely debilitating it is. I also wish that doctors would collaborate more with other doctors.
I think the biggest thing is please, please, please don't give up on your complex patients. Being a mother of one of those patients has been heart-wrenching. And you're all we have.
If I had one thing to say to physicians is that I would really, really hope that they would go back and review some of their patients, because really what I was told up until almost a year into my searching for answers was that I was 50 years old, clearly I was having menopausal symptoms, and that I should go home, have less stress in my life, and get lots of sleep and lots of exercise, and could I possibly meditate?
I think that every single doctor should know the symptoms, and every single neurologist shall know how to do a diagnostic, knowing exams and treatments for all, let's say, CSF leak types. People are suffering too much from this condition. It's not acceptable.
SIH is a cruel disorder. It affects not just the patient, but it affects the lives of the people around him. You become someone else's burden. And I know that some people don't even have someone to care for them. With regard to family and friends, you disappear from their lives. You become like a ghost. SIH isn't just a leaking of fluid from one's dura. It's a leaking away of one's life.